I have particular concerns about elder abuse and about pressure that might be put on elderly people to access a euthanasia system. This is an area of criminology that has gained a lot of attention in the last 5 years, and there's been a realisation internationally that this type of crime, which can be hidden in people's homes, has been neglected by researchers, that if you like, we're 20 or 30 years behind the study of domestic violence or different types of child abuse. Research tells us internationally that there's all different types of elder abuse, including financial abuse, severe psychological abuse, that, and this is an important point, victims are very reluctant to talk to people about their experiences, including to talk to researchers, for a wide variety of reasons. I know in our own state that TASCOS has been very interested in this area of elder abuse, and that the state trustee in Victoria has commissioned research on this particular topic. Well, even less research has been conducted on the issue of pressure in euthanasia systems or in systems of assisted suicide. There have been some quantitative studies, but it's very difficult to actually measure pressure quantitatively in numbers. What we really need are qualitative studies to hear people's personal experiences. And I'm only aware of one such study that's been conducted in Europe, but its scale and its design was not intended to discover the scale or the prevalence of pressure that patients experience in a euthanasia system. I think that we need to be aware that some elderly people may well have been subject to severe psychological forms of elder abuse. And if I might, I would make reference to a quote from a Tasmanian lady who told researchers about her experience of living with her son. And this is one of a number of stories that was uncovered by a researcher here a couple of years ago. She said, "He knows he can do with me what he likes because there's no one here to help me and I can't cope with it very well. We sit here in the dining room, chair to chair, and he never spoke to me for 7 weeks. He said I hadn't been a mother, I'd been an enemy. I don't know how he got like this. Now I am like this, I am nothing. I'm worth nothing anymore." I think that vignette or that quote starts to make us realise that there will be some elderly people who have been subject to psychological abuse and who will be particularly vulnerable to suggestions that they access, for example, a system of euthanasia. What would be the motives for people to do that? Now, I'm not suggesting that this will be necessarily widespread. And I think in the main, the people who are interested in euthanasia are interested in it for compassionate reasons. But human nature being what it is, it is clear that there will be some people who will be motivated by financial gain to pressure their elderly loved ones into accessing voluntary euthanasia. I think it would be very difficult. Look, safeguards may have some effect, but when we are talking about people who have been convinced through, for example, the types of things I'm concerned about, severe psychological abuse, that they have been convinced to request euthanasia, that they will appear as having a very genuine desire for euthanasia. And I'm not sure how any type of professionals always going to be able to tell the difference or detect when in actual fact the request has been motivated by someone else, by someone else's desires or behaviour. Equally, I can't see how creating, for example, an offence to cover, if you like, improper influence. So if you make it a crime to put pressure on people to request euthanasia, I can't see how that's going to be very effective, because as we've been discussing about the nature of elder abuse, it tends to be a very hidden crime. It's not the type of behaviour that leaves a lot of evidence behind. And in fact, the pressure that may be exerted on a patient to request euthanasia may incorporate pressure not to tell people about the conversations that have led to that decision. I think there is a real risk that maybe not just in 12 months or 5 years, but in decades to come, the scope of the legislation will broaden, and there will be pressure from the community to broaden the scope. I think it will be difficult for the community to differentiate in terms of serious human suffering between just physical suffering and mental suffering. And I think that people will argue, as they have in other countries, that, for example, patients suffering from dementia should be able to access a system of voluntary euthanasia. Is there demand for that sort of thing in Australia? Well, I could briefly make reference to a study that was published last year of mercy killings, prosecutions of people who helped their loved ones to commit suicide. And between 2000 and 2009, there were 11 such prosecutions that were reported and the researchers were able to find. Now, out of those, the suffering that was sought to be alleviated was depression in 2 of the cases, dementia in another 3 of the cases, and Alzheimer's disease in the other case. Total of 6 cases. In a total of 6 cases, the family member was motivated to assist their elderly relative or loved one to attempt suicide on the basis of that type of mental suffering. So I think that suggests to us, and should suggest to policymakers, that if not now, there will be at some stage demand in some sectors of the community to broaden the scope and to change the rules about access to voluntary euthanasia. I think if we expanded a system of voluntary euthanasia or assisted suicide to include mental suffering, it causes a disconnect between major policy platforms. On the one hand, you'd have this new system, which essentially enabled people to end their life because of mental suffering. And then on the other hand, we'd have a different policy platform dealing with suicide prevention, and messages going out through things like Beyond Blue, for example, which were had a completely different message. One about trying to convince people that no matter how they felt, no matter what their mental state, they are valuable members of society and that there will be help for their suffering. I just cannot see how 2 completely different policy platforms will be able to sit next to each other happily and without contradiction. Mm-hmm.